New NY with Jovan the Last Don and DJ First Choice. Power 105.1.
Power 105.1, home of that Breakfast Club. Angie Martinez, of course, on Sunday nights, we take over, man. New NY. Man, Sundays at 10 o'clock. I can't even put it into words how excited I am right now. If you're a fan of music, if you're a fan of culture, if you're a fan of if you love something, we got incredible Mr. Eric Sermon in the building
That's
tonight.
A great intro. That's I love the intro. The class are coming later on.
They will. Listen, first and foremost, thank you.
Facts.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Thank you, man.
Not only are we honored to have you in the building on this show, but we are respectful to what it is to even come to do something like this. We're not a mainstream radio show. We're on mainstream radio, but this is something for the unsigned, to the upcoming artists. And we are so appreciative to have you in the building tonight, sir. Like, first and foremost, all I want you to do right now is we're going to break a little bit of the format. I want to play something that you want to hear.
Okay.
Right out the gate. What song do you want to hear? Just either off your stuff.
Whatever.
Your new album is coming soon.
Okay. Yeah. You know what? Let's do something out there. Let's go into Reservoir Dogs.
Oh, my God.
Listen.
Is that how we start the show?
Listen. Perfect. Let's get right to
what
it.
What a tone to set.
Oh, man.
We'll be right back.
New and why, baby. Eric Sermon is in the one of building.
One of the gods is in the building tonight.
Let's get it.
We'll be right back. 800-585-1051 is number. Text us at 41051. We got the most... I don't want to sound disrespectful if I say it, most underrated.
Yes.
Because you
no,
are.
No. That's a good word.
Would that be accurate?
That all the time. Very accurate.
Okay.
Very
accurate. I didn't know if that would.
No.
Because you have a claim.
I love it. Absolutely. People, I love it. No, it's underrated, though.
Okay. Because if I had to go. Recently, I was talking to Choice about how Puffy has reassembled the Hitmen.
Yes.
And he's brought back in, you know, Carlos Brody. Stevie J's back. You know, my guy Mario Juan is back.
God, yeah.
The team is back.
That's dangerous.
D-Dot. And rumor has it that they've also put the homie back in. Kanye West is an honorary member.
Okay. I know that part.
Right. So I say that to say I'm looking for Easy Mo B.
I say that
to say I'm looking for maybe, I don't know, maybe a Pete Rock here and there.
Yeah.
I say that to say, dare I say, I'm looking for Eric Sermon. On the last No Way Out 2 album for Puffy.
Right. Hey, when you mentioned Easy Mo B, answer this question for me. If Biggie Smalls had one of the dopest albums in the world, why hasn't nobody came and got Easy Mo B? I don't understand why he never did nothing after.
Well, I think I may have an answer for that, but I don't know if it's too early in the interview to get into that part.
No, let's go, because this is going to be uncut.
I think there's a disconnect with the new generation and the generation prior. I think for some reason in hip-hop, we don't appreciate and we don't salute our generals, the guys who came before us, the way that other genres do. If you go to rock and roll.
Or country.
Or country music. Even reggae music. Because you can, and even a dance hall or whatever, you can go to a dance hall concert and you can put Barris Hammond, who is a classic reggae singer, with the new reggae artist. You know what I mean? With hip-hop, it seems like there's a disconnect between the two of them. You know what I mean? So I think that's the reason why the new generation would not want to put someone who produced or worked on Biggie's classic project. Right. You dig what I'm saying? I don't know why that is.
I'm glad you said that, because I always had the question that you asked just now about Dame Grease, about DMX.
Wow.
And I say to myself, how is it that Dame started that sound and then Swiss was allowed to just take it all the way over?
Right.
No disrespect to Swiss.
Right.
But you got PK.
Yeah.
You got other producers that created that molded that. And even with you, I feel like when I was going and I started making music, just like music.
Ooh, classic.
And when that came out, what you did to that and you brought Marvin back in a hip hop form, I don't even think they appreciated it then.
Yeah. I think, again, I was just saying, not even this era, I was saying, like, right after Biggie Smalls' album came out,
that's what I'm saying.
Easy Mo B still was not.
Okay,
he was because that, no disrespect to Puff though, Puff became someone different.
You're right,
and he became something.
You're right,
uncontrollable.
You're right.
So there was nobody to tell him that you need to reach back, because he couldn't hear that.
Yeah, but not even Puff, though. I just figured that the world would go and grasp
the, him. The world at that time wasn't paying attention to what the artists were. They were paying attention to what Puff was giving what the artist would
okay,
be.
Okay, I got you.
You know what I mean?
I got you.
It wasn't that. It was okay. Puff was more powerful than the artist.
I got you.
You got to remember, most of the time when Puff created the artist, he was rapping the artist that he was getting ready to bring out before they came out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Loons, mm-hmm. the Maces. His verses came before they came out.
Okay.
Remember that.
I got you.
So I feel like right now, I feel like this is the time that this is a perfect time for you to come out.
I think at this particular time, too, I think that we need to have another surge of hip-hop music. Not saying that, because, again, I had to come after Run DMC.
Mm-hmm.
After me had to come Wu-Tang Clan, Bad
mm-hmm.
Boy,
Bad Boy,
Murder, Inc., Rockefeller. This mm-hmm. is, again, but it still had a format of hip-hop.
Right.
Like, Hard Knock Life still was a hip-hop sampled hip-hop
Absolutely.
Record.
Oh, yeah.
The format of hip-hop was still there, meaning that people would be like, yo, why are you categorizing? Because I said, we're the only genre who don't have categories. If Janis Joplin was alive, she would be like, hey, Britney Spears, you don't belong in here. You a pop singer.
Right.
Mm. They made a pop category for Britney Spears
right.
and all them other pop artists. So here's alternative rock, soft rock,
hard
heavy
rock,
metal.
Heavy metal.
So and so we only have one category.
So you think that hip hop should have been categorized in subgenres?
We're the only one that don't have
he's
it.
Right.
So, well, you got easily listening jazz, soft jazz.
Contemporary jazz.
True.
So we putting everything in here that might be trapped, that might be, conscious, what they calling Kendrick now, or this might here might be dance rap. We need to have that. I bet you won't even be this much confusion. Like, everybody that's doing hip hop won't be as angry.
Right.
I told people too, you have to be careful to be noticed as the mad rapper. My era is so angry that we looking crazy because it's like, yo, you can't be mad at what they're doing.
But I think
hold your thought. I want to play one more record with you. This is going because we only have 55 minutes.
Go.
This might be a two-part show.
It might have. It's definitely gonna.
I feel like let's go to another record.
Okay. Yes.
I gotta go grab something real quick, and I wanna come back, and we're gonna talk.
Let's get it.
He's here. The icon.
Eric Sermon is in the building, baby. New and Wild Power 105.1. All right, man, we in the building. Javon the Last Don, First Choice. We got the legend in the building. The man himself, Eric Sermon, is here with us right now, man. Behind the scenes, we were just talking about, I had to salute him
mm-hmm.
because, you know, I'm a DJ nerd,
right.
first and foremost. So I had to salute him and had to salute DJ Scratch.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I had to pay my homage real quick.
Shout out,
if you listen, it's homie, salute you. I'm a
shout
big
to Def
fan.
Squad.
Def Squad. Oh, man.
Def Squad. Like,
crazy.
You did one album, I know. So, you know what's so bugged out? The one album. Not knowing that, again, you know, we go number one the whole night. We beat out Maxwell. I was excited we beat out Maxwell because he was yapping, though, too. Like, you would never know that, though, but he was. Because he knew he had number one.
Maxwell's from New York, so he wanted to compete.
Yes.
That's
yes,
all.
Yes, and we beat him by 8,000 records. That
That's a Brooklyn guy right there.
You know, but the Death Squad, it was never able to go again because Red and Meth came.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Red and Meth messed up the whole thing of the crew because they blew up.
Well, let me ask you a question. Do you think that messed it up, or was it was in the divine plan? Because at that time you were an anomaly
mm-hmm.
because you created something in
that word. I love education. Go on, boy.
Hey man, listen.
You got some intelligence up here, new one, man.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm a fan first,
right?
You know, and I appreciate what you have given us as a gift to the culture because I have digested your stuff.
Okay, mm-hmm. thank you, appreciate that.
You know, and on some grown man, grown man, I feel like it's important for us to understand that line of where you've given us. I've picked up some things and I've not been able to recreate it, but I've learned from it to be able to paint my own pictures.
Yes.
So it's important for us to know that from a DJ standpoint, from producer to even a new fan. He's a young guy. It's got Cuddy, right? He's from Jersey. He's and Jersey right now is on fire.
As soon as I saw him, matter what, I gave him a pound and hugged him. No matter what, that's just me.
But that's you though.
Because again, the vibe I pick up. Mm-hmm. I want these young kids to know that, yo, man, at the end of the day, there's people out here fighting for you. Like again, I don't gotta do this.
Not even fighting, but half fought.
Boasting, I don't got to do none of this.
No, talk it, please.
I rock this because I'm at home.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Because I was gone for 12 years from the game.
Right.
And I'm at the crib, and I'm like, yo, you know, they don't got to do this. They can be, go Kanye West in 1994 one time, said, yo, I'm doing 94 hip hop. Now, the kids don't know what he meant by that, right. But he was talking about Souls of Mischief, Tribe, De La, the whole nine. Mm-hmm. So his style that he was doing was 94 hip hop.
Can you stop right there for a second? I don't even mean to cut you off. I just told this young guy, it was myself, DJ Create, and Cuddy. We were in the room, and I said, I want to show you something. 93 of November to October of 94 was when all this came out. You had Nas, Biggie, you had J. Rude the Damager.
Yeah.
You had...
was Mob?
No.
Mob came 95, 96.
Mob came 95, 96. Okay. Yeah. But you had the Fugees.
Right.
You had Brandy 94.
Right.
The amount of music that poured out and was allowed to enter the atmosphere,
right,
whether it be radio or just consumer-wise,
right,
was so much more then than now. Why is that now that we are so limited to what we're allowed to hear and consume? What do you think that is?
We need people like you.
They y'all, fight me, though.
Y'all to do this. But you don't have to fight. See, the reason why you don't got to fight because you're going to win. Because, again, I'm going to name two people. J. Cole.
Kendrick Lamar.
Kendrick Lamar are the number one sellers.
Right.
Facts.
Meanwhile, he's telling you, J. Cole is saying, yo, they took our music before. Mm-hmm. And then he says, Timberlake, like right in the middle of the record, like, yo, this man is second
verse.
What? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Second verse.
It's a chance that you're going to take that. You're going to mess up and get blackballed. You just missing two big people.
Right.
Iggy, and you right. called and them and you mm-hmm. you said, listen, they, you know, incredible.
But but why is it that there's so many or so less or so few
because
of those?
Because people don't want to take, they think that they won't, they're going with what the quickness is now as far as the business, as far as what's going to be here faster for me to do this. Because Kendrick even said too, if I do hip hop, it's a harder road for me.
Right.
That's what he thought it was going to be a harder road for him. Meanwhile, I got two nieces, 22 years old. They said, Uncle Eric, yo, we get ratchet, but I spent my money on J. Cole.
Right.
That's what Choice just said.
But that's, that's class, right. though. Facts. That's class.
But I'm saying, they'll go and party and get turned up.
But
the dollar was spent on the actual album that I figured that the body of work is going to be on this CD. So I'm a rock with this.
Mm-hmm. But even to go back to what you said earlier about, like, you know, the subgenres in hip-hop, I think that there isn't, like, literally subgenres of hip-hop, but I think people personally create that. I think people understand that, yo, I like this hip-hop. I go to the club to hear this kind of music, but I want to hear this kind of music on my personal time.
Exactly.
You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. I don't think it has to be.
Wait. But are you, and I want to include you in this, do you feel like that's something that the intellects go and they talk about?
Right.
Because there's other people who don't care.
Choice, what I'm saying is this. How come we can't have it? If any other genre of music has it,
I definitely
we should
agree.
Be able to have a category.
Absolutely.
It makes it fun.
It makes
just to be like, yo, in this category of hip hop, Tyler Kwali, Mos Def, so and so, whatever.
Right.
And they got that category. That's dope, but then you got, and the new trap is going to be Rich Homie Quan, Young Thug Boom. That's dope.
But it starts here.
To have Childish Gambino, to have
a
YG.
A Flatbush Zombies. Joey Badass.
Troy
Ave.
Action Bronson. Exactly.
To have that, but
because they're never going to see it this way.
But so do you have an answer?
I wish I had enough power myself to go into that and go into American the Music Awards, to go into Billboard, to go into the Grammys and say for the powers that be, the Clive Davises, MC Light 2 on the board, Fabio Freddy on the board, and say, listen, man, you should get some categories. You should get categories for so you won't put TLC in hip hop, Mary J. Blige in hip hop, along with anything that's got something to do with a little bit of hip hop and rapping goes into the hip hop category. Chris Brown, all of it go into the category.
Right.
And that's not how it should be. We're the only ones that's doing that.
But ultimately,
they ain't doing it.
Ultimately, what would that change though? As far as the music itself, what would that change?
It would give a platform for each individual so they can feel like, okay, we have something to get noticed on.
Okay.
As far as the people who are sitting here, don't forget, these people, they ain't getting no radio play.
Right. Mm-hmm.
They might yell and say, I don't care about that. No, they do, though.
Now I have a question for you, and I want you to please, I need, you've been so candid so far. Okay. Does radio matter?
I think the reason why radio matters is because there's people out there that want to listen to y'all, but don't because of the amount of repetition of the same song.
Right.
So they chose to go to the other
Spotify's
and internet radios.
Yeah.
But even they are conforming because the business then got them too.
Right. Oh, yeah. It's
But believe me. Anybody who's saying, I don't care. No, they not lying. The truth.
It's
not. Ain't nothing like being on the so-and-so, and next thing you know,
seven o'clock,
6 o'clock come around, your song come on, so-and-so. There's nothing like that, B. Right.
I want to be a fan again for a second. I want you to tell me when the first time it was that you heard your record on the radio.
Yeah, I was at Parrish's dad's apartment, and we used to hear Red Alert play the break beat because 7 minutes of funk is a break beat for It's My Thing, which is Jay-Z used for Ain't No Nigga.
Absolutely.
So, we used to hear it regular, but I always had the helicopters in front of it. When the helicopters
came on.
My pen and my pad is out. Yeah. I'm listening.
So when the helicopters came on, we knew that.
It's yours.
And that was our song. And we didn't have the two ways. Back then, as far as the phone, even when you called, there was no click over.
Right.
So every phone was busy.
Right.
So, but it happened at that moment at Paris's.
Do you remember what you were doing at that moment?
We was just sitting there waiting because we had went and met Red Alert.
Got
you. He dissed us at the club. Like we went to go see him at Latin Quarters, and he was like, "Yo, we gonna play it." Because Latin Quarter was open to 4 in the morning.
Of course.
2 passed by, 3 o'clock in the morning passed by. It's like 4 people in there, us two and Red Alert.
Mm-hmm.
And he still didn't play it.
See, new rappers, it's not only you.
It happens to Eric Sermon also.
And look where he's
exactly
at now.
But let me tell y'all a quick story about these rappers, too, that y'all, for those who like Rick Ross, if y'all go on YouTube and Rick Ross have interviews, my name come up a lot. Because when Rick Ross was coming in the game, he was signed to Tony Draper, which was Suave House. And Tony Draper dropped Rick Ross at my house for a whole month. His name was Teflon. I was in my basement doing records on Rick Ross for a long time. And I put him on my 1999 album.
You did.
So-and-so.
Yes, you did.
And those people talk about the rappers that I had. When I talk about people that was in front of me. I did 50 Cent after How to Rob. Tony Polk brought him to me, and he was in my basement. I did 8 songs on them, and then we finally got a song called Heat Wave.
Right.
They don't do it like we do. Right. So
You've incubated a lot of them.
Right. So again, 50 Cent, I was, moving in that. Ludacris.
Yes.
In Atlanta.
Yes.
Was coming to my house with a DAT tape. I was young. I had the Wu-Tang Clan. I had Game. I had Biggie. These people that they talk about, people who came in front of them.
Eric, hold on a second, Eric. Where in your mind do you place yourself as far as in the fabric of hip hop when it comes to when they mention the Dr. Dre's on the West Coast?
They got to mention my name when they mention him, because I tell you what, back in when EPMD had the second album, we had a song called Big Payback where the whole NWA is in the video. I get kidnapped. They call Dre and them. Dre and them come down. Easy, whole nine, along with Tone Loco, along with DOC. They all came in the video. I felt that the East Coast NWA was EPMD. Whatever we was doing, they was doing, and we was just neck and neck. Me and Cube became tight.
Yes.
Matter of fact, when Cube broke up from NWA, I took him on tour with me, Luke Skywalker tour, and he was like, "Yo, I think I'm gonna leave the group." And me and Paris sat down and talked with him. The next thing you know, he was in New York working with the Bomb Squad.
Right, and created one of the most incredible.
This is so crazy right here.
The reason why I asked you, because I know sometimes it's a lot of times, especially with our culture and our music, we are so braggadocious all the time.
Yeah, right.
And we get smacked down a lot because we talk about our accolades.
Yeah.
But I wanted to know from your mouth and your brain, like,
I can't do it. You know what? I wish I could. I sit here and I have fun and be joking.
Right, right.
I joke with myself. Like, right. Oh, what?
Right, right.
Crazy. Right. They didn't do nothing, but I did all this, you know, whatever. Because I look at my resume and be like, yo, I'd say, you know, people think about rap, it's R&B. D'Angelo, Chico DeBarge, everything. Mary J. Blige, SWV, In Vogue, it was Angie Stone, if it's Brownstone, like, it, you know, from Blackstreet to Dave to whatever. The R&B just as big as the hip hop. So, but they won't know that unless they read it. Even my girl be like, I didn't know you did that. Yeah, this is. I'm not gonna tell you all that. If it come out, my colleagues is the ones that give me the most props.
Right.
Besides the producers, I mean the fans though too. Right, but my colleagues are one of the ones that, like, when Pharrell sees me, he bows, and I hate that. Like, what are you doing that for?
Let me ask you a question. Do you still love it?
You know what? This is bugged out. I had a conversation with Keith Murray the other night, and I said, Keith, this Floyd Mayweather said too, he doesn't love boxing.
And then he did say that recently.
You might think it's bugged out.
Mm-hmm.
I love the fact that the new people are doing hip hop. So me, I like the fact that,
like the guys you mentioned, you talking
about. Yes, okay. Flatbush Zombies and some, even in a Bodega Bands. This little Puerto Rican is
he's not even playing.
Like, how you not hot here? You know, so those type of people that I look at and see the underground, whatever, gives it hope that we can have a balance. Listen, my kids is at home. Mm-hmm. But where you come? My way. I can't stop my 10-year-old son from that. So what are he gonna do? I'm not mad at him. But I gotta give him a choice to do something else though too. I just wanted him to be able to choose for something else that he might like.
Right,
and
right,
that's
right.
Where it come into play. Back then we had more balance.
Right.
It was more balanced back then to say, okay, well you can get with this, you can get with that. Like how the choice of yours is.
Too. But to go back with you, like, you know what? To go back to what you said earlier, that balance still exists, though.
Not as much. It's more one-sided.
No, I agree with that 100%. Yeah, yeah. But I definitely believe, like you said, that my ways and those kind of stuff.
Not on the radio, though. The balance is there if you on the underground. That other balance is not on. It's not mainstream.
Right.
True. I mean, we only got one mainstream.
True. Right. True.
The one mainstream is that it. We got groups there, but they don't have a balance as far as mainstream radio.
But you got
radio.
The J. Cole's, you got the J. Cole's, and then you got the Fendi Watts.
You only mentioned two. Kendrick and J. Cole.
The whole world is another way.
Right.
Okay. That's not the balance. That's another scale compared
Let me ask you this. Was there a time when you felt like, all right, this is not for me anymore?
I did. I was gone for 12 years. I think that I'm the first one to give Just Blaze $60,000. He ain't never got that much money. I was the first one to give him that much money. Not Rockefeller, not Dame, not Jay. It came from me. I gave him $60,000 for that React record.
Wow.
When you talk about producers like a Just Blaze and like a Swiss Beats and a Alchemist or a Havoc and
oh my God. Guys,
so where are you? Disrespect, Primo. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, when you speak about these,
I'm sorry, Primo.
Yeah.
I said Primo. When you did Mass Appeal, you think I didn't know that those are my drums?
Right.
He started laughing. He said, how you know was you a customer? I said, because you, Puffy, with Mario Winans, with the I Don't Want to Know, I could tell it because I'm the Lind drum I had. Right. I only had the Lind drum that the people use. So when you did Mass Appeal, I heard it.
Hold on one second. Yeah. Just so you know, we're talking to the legend icon here. Eric Sermon's in the building. I know this is nerdy information for you. 800-585-1051. Yeah. We're talking. And for me, I don't get to talk this type of talk a lot because, you know, a lot of times we're always interviewing new artists.
Right.
Yeah. So it's hard to understand where I'm talking right now with this. This is massive information.
Crazy.
If you're a fan of music, if you're a fan of hip hop, you're gonna understand what we're talking about. Like, again, this is gonna be a two-part series.
People are gonna give it to Primo because of the name of more commercial as far as the name, but I got more body of work than any of them.
Right.
But as far as the name,
right,
I understand because, again, the Biggies and the Puff and the Jays, the whole nine.
How does that affect you, though?
It doesn't, because again, luckily it's documented.
Right.
See, if nobody knew,
right,
and
exactly,
couldn't
exactly
pull it up, it'd be like,
exactly.
But when the homework is done, it's like, you know, you can't hide.
Right.
You can't fake the numbers. You can't fake the internet or the papers or the body of work. You can't fake it.
800-585-1051. Yeah. I wanna go to a song real quick. We're gonna go to play some local stuff real quick. I wanna come back, but when we come back, I wanna talk to you about Def Squad.
Okay.
All right. Eric Sermon's in the building. Cuddy, First Choice.
We here, man.
My Last Don. Shout to PR Rod for putting this together, man. It
crazy,
is what it
crazy,
is.
Crazy, crazy.
Power 1051. It is what it is. New and wide. This is what we doing, man. Shout to Tony in the building. What up, Tone?
What up, Tony?
We back, man.
Yes, sir.
Yo, I have to say,
Tony's in the
in
building.
The presence of Eric Sermon, like
it's that's why I brought you in the room, Tony.
Tony.
Tell him your title.
I'm the director of digital programming and operations for iHeartMedia New York City.
So basically, he controls
that's huge.
It's
everything.
Huge,
I know.
He's from that digital team.
I said, I connect y'all, motherfucker.
I connect y'all at every level.
But the reason why I wanted to make sure that you saw me wave him in, and I know he walked past the shot, but I wanted to bring him in because Tony and I have had a conversation about hip hop. And he was talking about how he loved it so much. I've been in the bars with Tony. You know, for those that don't know, Tony's this short white guy from and he's Philly.
Right.
But he loves hip hop.
Oh my God, Mr. Philadelphia. Why would he love hip hop? That's some of the best DJs in the world.
Right.
Some of the dopest MCs that came, Kev. A lot. Yeah.
So I want to go back to the question before we went to the break. I want to talk about Def Squad.
Okay.
In a millennial right now where we have individuality.
Right.
No one wants to do group work.
Right.
How did you assemble such an immense amount of great talent and be able to cultivate that? Even though it was for one album, they still wore Def Squad and they shouted Def Squad outside of that one album.
Yeah.
How were you able to pull that together?
Well, both of them were signed to me, so it wasn't even, I can't give you a whole big thing. They was both signed to me as artists. And again, once EPMD broke up, Russell was like, you know, what you gonna call yourself? I was like, you know, I like the squad part, so Def Jam was Def Jam. So I said, yo, I'm gonna call myself Def Squad. He said, okay, well, let's do it. We run with it. So I got a logo. I saw Puffy's Bad Boy logo with that little kid.
Right. Rapping it a little bit.
This is my first time saying this, I never said this live before.
That's what's up.
I saw that Bad Boy so because I know people got, you know, it was a big thing with the Nas and the Biggies, you know, this and that, but nah, I saw first thing came to my head was the Bad Boy logo, and I'm like, oh, okay, no, I'm the little kid, I'm gonna put some blocks down there, put the blocks or whatever like that, whatever, and then Leo Cohen was like, yo, that's a dope ass logo, you know what I'm saying, so.
Wow.
You know, because, but as far as this, but me,
that's history.
I was rhyming with Redman the whole time, so, and Keith Murray the whole time when I brought him out with Hostile, so it was like, yo, let's just do this for. We didn't know. Listen, man, I made that record in about 3 weeks, and what happened was, it was fast going again. Put Your Hands was still influential. So my first single was Full Cooperation, which is Pharrell. This is what made Pharrell so ill. Pharrell said, Eric, listen, man, if you didn't make that record, I don't know where I was going to be going because you gave me the format to make boom, boom, shake it fast. Don't forget.
Right.
Full Vibration is boom, 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 cha-cha. So when it came out, people thought that I did Mystical. They thought that Danger was
Danger
all me. Pharrell played 19 records in the Jay-Z session. The 19th record was, I'm a hustler, baby, but was boom, 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 my format.
Right.
Wow.
So, but again, I'm not saying that as braggadocious, but
why he salutes you and he bows down when he sees you because you influence so much of his music.
Here's a question. I don't want to put you on the hook for anything, and I just want to know, do you like any of the music that you hear today?
Yes.
Outside of the Kendricks and
that's what I'm saying. Let me say something
Bug Dot too, man. Rich Homie Quan, melody wise, the records that he's dangerous.
At what point did you get
very dangerous?
You say you was out for 12 years.
Right.
What was the moment you decided, you know what, let me get back up, let me get back in the studio? You know, you got this new single out, you got the new album coming out.
It's
at
those
what point
two people.
Did you decide?
Kendrick and J. Cole. Mm-hmm. J. Cole got 3 breakbeats on his new album.
He does.
And Peace the President, he got something called Daz, which is the Cypress Hills of Killer Man. And one more I forgot. I think it's Long Red. But again, the way that he was doing it. And then, of course, Kendrick with the King Kunta, like,
right.
That's what I know L.A. is being. The L.A., the 1-2, mm-hmm. That record's what California is not doing, and I don't know why.
Well, but, well, Mustard dominated for the last 2 years. That's probably
right,
why.
But not that type of...
Right. I'm saying Mustard yes, sound yes. took over right. what L.A. really was.
Right.
Because Mustard, being that he's right. not, he's from right. L.A., but he's, you know, he's got the Bay right. sound.
Right.
It took over the L.A.
Yes.
sound.
You're right.
You
exactly.
know what I mean?
But those, what you said, what made me come is the fact that A$AP Nasty with Method Man.
Ugh. Ugh.
Joey Badass.
Yes.
Action Bronson. These are, everything you hear about the Action is all samples.
Hold on a second. The fact that you mentioned A$AP Nasty.
Right.
I remember playing his record 2 years ago.
Right.
Not that he hasn't done his due diligence and he's right. not working, but he hasn't really hit the forefront in New York yet, but he's probably one of the more New York sounding
right.
out of the whole crew.
Out the crew, but that's what I'm saying. Every crew has that. He's the hip hop side. Even
yes.
though that if you listen to A$AP
Ferg
sometimes
Ferg.
Too yes. on the mic freestyle, he got it too.
100%.
But they choose to do the business.
Right.
So I'm not mad at.
Right.
But those records, the Flappers Zombies, those people who are out there doing that hip hop music is why I was able to say, okay, you know what? Hey, let's go. So me, knowing that I look at Sheik Lutz, I don't look at him as being third. I never did. I always thought he was dangerous.
It's different. Yep.
But again, people would always be, yeah, he's the third one out of the locks. You know, they all dope.
Right.
You know
right,
what I'm saying?
Right,
but
right.
Sheik was always ill.
They all had their own individual
exactly.
styles though. Mm-hmm.
Joel Ortiz is supposed to be as big as pun
bigger.
Was
bigger.
In New York City. He's one of the nicest
bigger.
Lyricists
yes.
right. that I have encountered to be in front of and effortlessly
right.
do
right.
verses.
Oh
and but the verse that he did on my record, not because it was mine, I don't know what made him and Sheik give me that,
mm-hmm.
but they gave it to me.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't have to. They did mad records. But Sheik, the way the way he came on, the whole record.
You want me to tell you why? Should I tell you why?
What?
Because you're a producer.
Yeah, yeah, but he said that.
You're not a beat maker.
Yeah, he said that.
You did what you're supposed to do.
You gotta stop before I come over
which
there.
Which is
take
a disconnect.
I'm gonna come take your neck off right now.
You know what?
The reason why I said this is because, too, people don't understand, too, as far as, like, you know, two people say, yo, I love you, or being in love with you is two different things.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
A producer and a beat maker. A beat maker makes a beat, go in there, let the guy get on there and rock the whole nine, so on and so. He doesn't produce the artist.
Right.
A lot of these people who don't make it and wonder why, yo, that beat was crazy. What happened? It wasn't produced.
Right.
Producers is like, hey, Choice, that verse is dope, but that verse shouldn't go first. It should go third.
Right.
That chorus is dope, but it don't mess with them verses.
Right.
I got to make sure that record is an actual song as a producer.
Producers take the do creativity
exactly.
out of the artist.
So, exactly. So that's what mm-hmm. that's what happens too. I can sit here and make a nobody because as a producer, I got to make sure that this song is dope. Don't forget, Sheik Lutz wasn't first in the category.
Right.
I was rocking. I'm looking. I'm like, dang, and it ain't about the money. I'm like, yo, he got to go first because it's exciting how, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So even with the 4-3-2-1, the order was totally different.
Mm-hmm.
So I just made the order so it sounds Ooh. Right in my head. The order wasn't like that. It was LL coming on first, then it was mixed up, and then Red and Meth wasn't together. So it was me fixing up the record, trying to make sure.
I hope you
trying to make sure that on Reservoir Dogs that, okay, well, Source Money, which is incredible. How are we going to be able to put the locks, Source Money, and
like,
then,
I'm gonna keep it so real.
And then people hearing Benny Siegel too for the first time on 4-2-2-1, hearing DMX.
Yes.
How I'm gonna make Stay Out the Dark? How I'm gonna make that work?
Let me ask you a question. Do you feel like the producers of the because they you have to call them producers because that's what they mm-hmm. want to call themselves at this point? Do you think that they have the tutelage or the pedigree to even
that? I tell you what, I have a son. His name is Countdown. He's 23 years old. He had this rapper called Kid Ink years ago. Yeah, I got this new rapper. He from L.A. I'm working with him. Mm. So all the mixtapes that Kid Ink did in the beginning was done by my son.
Mm.
He was doing the music from the Fruity Loops. You know me, I'm...
Yeah.
I don't
Machines.
Know nothing about that because I don't know about no computer...
Hardware.
You know, working for me.
Right.
You know, at the time. I said, nah, Dad, I got to work. So when he showed it to me, I'm like, yo, this is dope, what you doing. But I said, you know what? Eventually, you gotta know how to sample. I ain't doing that. I want all my publishing. So mm-hmm. I understand about that. But you got to be able to manipulate a sample, at least so you can have the texture of having sampling. So at the end of the day, I feel that hip-hop has to have that texture, because if not, it'll all sound like this from the computer.
Right.
To me.
No, no, no. Listen, you know? You're not the only one.
Okay.
You're not the only one. And the beauty of it is because, like I said, we have the legend, Icon, in the building. Eric Sermon in the building. Okay. This conversation could go for days.
Yeah, let's go. Okay, we're going to make room right now.
Let's do it. Yeah, let's do it. Matter of fact, introduce it. Introduce
this is Eric Sermon, Joel Ortiz, Sheik Lutz. This is Slaughterhouse and Death Squad and the Locks together.
Potent.
This is crazy.
Potent information
off
right
the
straight
album,
New
right?
York, off the new album, ESP, Eric Sermon Perception, August 21st.
Oh, man. Let's get into it, baby. Yeah. New and Wild, Power 105.1.
800-585.
I like the record, though.
105.1 is the number. Text us at 4105.1. We have the esteemed, the elite in the building, Mr.
Yes,
Eric Sermon.
Yes, yes.
Now, does it ever get weird for you as far as when you listen to music on the radio and you listen to something that you're like, you know where it comes from? And, is there a disconnect when you're listening to radio? Do you listen to radio?
Yeah, I do. I do. Yeah. I think that, I think it's dope that, you know, say if Chris Brown come out with an SWV record, you know, whatever, and we know that's SWV, but the kids think that's Chris Brown's beat. You know? So I think that all the stuff that we're hearing now of Fabulous and Jada taking the beats, and even Meek Mill's taking the old Wu-Tang Clan and rhyming over it, is giving the education.
Right? A lot of that came from, I remember when Clue was putting that together, a lot of that came from Clue.
Oh, well, that's okay, that's Clue. Dope. Yeah. Okay, I was wondering where that was coming from.
Here's my segue point to that. Clue, who was here at the station all the time, when his era of his domination of the Clue tapes and stuff like that.
I don't know how, not to stop you, I don't know how Clue does it. Right. I know that it's a business.
Right.
But to know where you, to know what you know about hip hop. And then, see, Choice is different. This is his era.
This is his era.
But to you to come from that and then have to come and play all of this.
We talk about this all the time.
That right there, I want to know too.
This might be a different
part. Yeah, like, you know, and I understand the politics of it too, but what do you really feel like? I would want to know
He stated that.
Really feel? Because you can love some of it, but what do you know about when you're throwing 1-900 number? Like, what?
And he was in there.
Like,
right, he was there.
Single, y'all. Like, anything that you can think about when you. The excitement of what hip hop.
We speak about it all the time. We talk about and that face that you're
and
making,
like
the face that you're making right now is
like
what I try to express to my guys right here because they're younger than me, and I try to explain to them that. And you're one of those people who've created that longevity of
absolutely.
You gotta, I tell you what, play. Another example. I go on tour right now. I ain't been out in some. So matter of fact, I do. We EPMD. We came out 27 years ago, that the whole audience is sold out. You need 15 new people to pack out Giant Stadium. They all got to be hot. We don't got to be hot.
That's crazy.
We pack the same people. I do overseas. I'm over there with Big Sean just 2 weeks ago. I'm in the audience overseas in Europe.
Right.
With the same audience.
Right.
And I'm tearing the fucking building to pieces.
But, I mean, overseas, you know.
But I'm just saying, not even overseas.
In general.
Here.
Right, okay.
Two, it don't matter.
Right.
When I did Barclays.
Right.
And with LL Cool J, whatever, that night.
I remember.
And we did Rampage on stage. It was the talk of the night.
What's the secret? What is the secret?
It's records that's being made. Like, when you grew up to your parents playing any of them songs. You would never, ever forget those records. That melody, the song, the what it was, there's songs that come out that we don't even know about now.
Wait.
That's not here no more.
I have a question. You hit something with me. Because when I was growing up with my parents, my mother was more gospel oriented. My father, when he was around, was more so about Al Jarreau,
yes,
Ohio Players,
yes.
He had a diverse of everything,
right.
But I heard it though.
Right?
Is it because the fabric of the family is not family, So when we're listening to the music in the car, there's no engagement of that, like the father and the mother, or the unit of where the parenting
right.
passes the down. Like, you don't have to like the music, because I know I didn't like everything.
Yes, you want to go with choices doing.
Okay.
It's another whole conversation.
No, I want this conversation.
Because my generation, we messed up bad.
Okay.
Why do you say that?
Because we didn't do what our parents did.
With our children. That's what I was waiting for. Okay. This is what I was waiting for. Please okay. go.
We the disconnect comes Oof. From us.
Mm.
We dropped the ball. Mm. We dropped the ball big time. As the internet, which is not our fault, or social media that came in, or TV, we let them raise the children. Mm. And we let radio and music come in too, and we let everything pass. And we didn't do the... Even if we couldn't control it, we didn't do no discipline
right.
or no way of even playing the records, showing them to the records, showing them, telling them about, you know, life, anything. We didn't do nothing. I got a big fault to myself. When I look at my children, I'd be like, dang, you know, whatever. I did some of it, but we just, when they say what happened, it's us. It ain't got nothing to do with y'all.
Right. That was my next question.
Y'all did
right.
what y'all learned. When Ice-T was arguing with Soulja Boy, Soulja Boy said, yo, T, why you get mad at me? I only did what I know. Mm. And T apologized to him because Soulja Boy went on what he knew.
Right.
He made records how he knew how to make them right. and what he thought that he was supposed to be making.
Facts.
He didn't have nobody tell him nothing. We had somebody. I learned from Run DMC. Mm. I learned from my culture.
I've been waiting for this. I've been waiting for this conversation
speak
for
about
so long.
Each one teach one.
But I've been waiting for that conversation right there to happen for so long, because I was trying to figure out. I remember when my pops would play CD 101.9.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I remember hearing Dave Koz and those type of things. And not necessarily my taste, but I heard it though. So it was
y'all gotta stop, man. I got chills in my hold. Look at my
man, it's crazy right here.
Because again, we could listen, man. I'm here for y'all, and I know that when y'all done, it's gonna be crazy again. I'm telling you, Choice, man, all you gotta do is just do. Listen, man, if you do what you feel in here, everything is gonna happen for you.
You know what's so crazy?
All of it.
I spoke to a legendary DJ, one of my favorite guys who I look up to, DJ Goldfinger, and I spoke to him the other day,
legend.
Thursday,
mm-hmm.
and he told me that exact. I asked him specifically, if you had to give me any advice.
Mm-hmm.
What would the best advice be for you to give to me as a young DJ coming up? Mm. He said to me, be yourself and do what you truly love.
Whatever.
Do what you what comes from. That's exactly.
You're going to be unstoppable.
Those were almost his exact
you're
words.
You're going to be unstoppable.
So that,
that means whatever you see where you look at your place, that part, you're going to be unstoppable.
Facts.
Because this is the only, the truth. Nothing else matters. Like, you can fabricate something, they're gonna expose you.
Mm-hmm.
No matter what, it's gonna come out. You're gonna be exposed.
This is crazy.
No matter what, wow. I don't give a fuck how you playing it off.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so you got that those Mellow. Dunks to match that too. No matter what, Tupac said too. Make people feel your pain, meaning that if you happy. Make them see that. If you sad, make them see that.
Mm.
But meaning that, keep it real with yourself. Because no matter what, somebody's going to expose you. And when you get exposed, then you end up like nothing. Then your career's gone.
Right.
Your respect is gone.
Right.
Everything that you're trying to do is going to be hated on.
Right.
Because we don't believe in you now.
Nah.
Because you was playing, and you was going along with the program, and you was so-and-so because you wasn't keeping it real with yourself.
Right.
You keep it real with yourself, and you're going to be, ain't nobody going to be able to stop you.
Mm.
I've been here for 28 years, man. I look at people, I sit here, and I be laughing sometimes. Like, if they only knew, all you got to do is just do you, and you will win.
But how hard and how jaded is the people nowadays, because now with this internet, and with the social media, you got to be so much more than yourself in order to just keep up.
Hey, listen, and that's the perception of it.
Right.
And that's what they want to give you. But me, as being, again, I'm also spiritual too. I believe in so I think that God plans are different. He's bigger than all this.
But
I don't care what. Yo, you know what I say too? When I look at people and people, like, why I never been touched before, people go out in the street and people talk smack because the posse I roll with is only one person.
Right.
And ain't nobody messing with him. So that's why I be like, every time I do something, no matter what, I've never been to the point where people used to ask me too. Even D-Dot, like, yo, one time in 98, he was like, yo, yeah, I bet you Eric Sermon made it. Y'all play the record. Because at one time, I was just smoking.
He was that hot.
He was like, yo, and I'm like, what made him say? Because I just felt like if I'm going to stop, if somebody's going to stop me, it's going to be me that stopped me.
Right.
It won't be an individual. But like, you know what? I don't even like Choice's playlist. The stuff that he playing in the club, I don't even feel in that. Matter of fact, boom, 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 that's a hater. You know that you hot.
Right.
You know your playlist is when you drop record and you drop here, okay, at this time I'm going to drop this or I'm going to go into this, boom, but you know what you're doing.
Right.
But that other person would make you think that, yo, you ain't hot. No, you go from here.
Right.
And nobody's going to be able to stop you, not one person.
That was probably incredible.
I
mean, right there.
I got another question for you. Where the mentor is at? I had a conversation with Busta Rhymes about a month and a half ago, okay? He's a good friend, and he's a big brother to me.
Mm.
And I ran into him up here. He came up to see, he was working one of his artists, and he came up here, and we had a conversation about Bobby Shmurda.
Right.
And he was disappointed in how the system was treating this, the label at that point was treating the situation as the urgency to help this man who has earned them surplus income. And I said to him, I said, we need more of you. And I said, because of you, there's somebody out there that can be inspired. But despite the fact that he's a living legend and can tear down a stage at any point by himself.
I was always seeing with him, too. He was tearing the whole, the earth had moved.
I'm just going to shorten it up and I'll say E, if you don't mind.
Yeah, go ahead. Crazy?
Where are the mentors for us?
Let me tell you something short. I was doing an interview. I think I forgot what station it was. It was guys like you, young dudes. I mean, talented kids. And I was speaking. He said, Mr. Sermon, if you was leading, I would follow you.
Mm-hmm.
Yo, my whole, I was like, don't put that on me. But just because I was given something that he wanted to hear, other than that,
right?
He made that statement. So I hear where you at.
Right.
Believe me, I wish I knew any one of our peoples that was able to. Yo, I'm cool, man.
Q-Tip, where are y'all? We need you.
And you got to do something. People got to do something like that. Listen, man, when the world was going through something, self-destruction was made. Fight the power.
Shout out to
D-Nice. We Are the World was made.
Mm-hmm.
Same Gang was made. Everybody was doing something to say, okay, before it get out of hand, nothing's bigger than the record. The song is the most biggest. There's talking, then there's music, the universal language. One song of anything or any type of song so will get at least somewhat of a feel of people caring if somebody would put something together.
But
like
I
that.
Here's where I don't agree.
Okay.
Only this is the first time throughout the whole interview that I disagree, because I was on social media. I think I went on Worldstar 3 days ago, and I saw that Kendrick Lamar had did a shoe unifying both sides.
Oh, the Bloods and Crips, yes.
The Bloods and Crips. And it scoffed.
Wow.
They laughed at it.
Wow.
Fool. You know they ain't gonna, a sneaker gonna kill this.
Right.
So when those things happen, and
but
you try to make those
then,
efforts.
Though.
But what I'm saying to you is, the records that you named, D Nice, Quincy Jones. These are the producers behind those particular records, right?
Right.
What happened to the? And I always talk about the Irv Gotti's and the Leo Cohen's.
Hey, yo, let me cut you off. Choice, you have a partner. Yo, I know. Yo, you better not be in here messing with Choice. So and so, because sometimes he'll be like, yo. Yo, enough, nigga. Like,
I know.
Get off the cooler, nigga.
Hey, like, hey, listen.
I know.
That's the whole that's done, man.
Society.
I know.
Get your ass off the cooler.
Yeah. That's
he
want to
get the 40.
Yeah.
Like, yo, why you always preaching all the time, man? Yo, man, because you know my book.
Man.
Mr. Society. And I get it. So just know, like, listen, man, what you doing, that passion is incredible.
Right, and exactly.
Like, if you want to set something up, the talk, I don't know.
No,
to
I do.
But I'm here. I'm here to say, yo, if you figured that Buster, which is one of my friends too. Uh-huh. At the end of the day, hey, let's. I'm with it too.
I say this all the time. I look at LL Cool J.
Right.
I look at Busta Rhymes. I look at Dougie Fresh.
Right.
I look at Kool Herc.
Right.
I look at maybe some of the closer ones. I look at even now. I still look at the Flexes and the Clues.
I think Kanye West though, man.
Kanye West is still too much of a pop culture.
I know,
thing.
But he's still a person who will bark.
He would.
When he needs to. Come on, anybody that's still making Splat Skinhead or still make or still calling crackers on the record, still making saying whiteys. Like, I mean, that means he can say something.
Him, Pharrell. In that category, you got a bunch of them. Him, Pharrell. You know, Kanye, Kendrick, J. Cole, the Radicals. I appreciate that, but here's where I'm coming back to, and I want you to really understand where I'm coming from. There's a difference between the radical and the teachers.
I got you.
Sometimes the teachers don't necessarily need to be radical because there's students in the room that don't necessarily mesh with that.
Right. I got you.
You're a teacher.
Right.
And the people I named before that are teachers. Even though Buster's an amazing performer on stage, there's a humbling that comes about him when he starts to talk.
Right.
He's a teacher.
Right.
Q-Tip, a teacher. Questlove,
yeah,
a teacher.
Q-Tip. Buster Rhymes said, remember that teacher. One year Buster Rhymes at the Hip Hop Awards and said, listen, anybody want to go against me on this stage?
I welcome you. I welcome you.
Right. That was just him as a veteran speaking like, I don't care for what y'all doing. When it comes to this, you can't touch me with this. Y'all got to step back. And they do, because they don't know how to perform. They giving shows to children who don't know that
they don't
you
vomit
over the track or you so-and-so. They don't know you ain't doing nothing.
Somebody just made a comment, and respect to Meek Mill for being the number one record last week. Somebody just said, when is Meek going to stop going over his tracks?
I know.
You know, Jay stopped a long time ago. Yeah. When is Meek going to stop? Even that is, it's, but there's no... Within the workings of the music industry, the mentorship has stopped.
You're right.
Well, you know what? My opinion on that, I think the solution is, because like you said earlier,
the solution is it's here today.
No, hold on. My opinion is that, like, you know, you said that there was a disconnect with you and, you know, the people who came after you, your children, you know, there was a disconnect with how you raised your kids or whatever. I think because we lost that from that gap until now, that the solution is that we start here again.
Exactly.
We start
that's
right
what
here
I just
now.
Said. You know what I'm saying? I just said that. I feel
right
good.
With knowing
I feel
why,
good because
you know what I mean?
Right.
Of y'all.
Yeah, like, you know what I'm saying? But, so this is where it starts again.
But if you... Yo, man, Choice, if you fuck up my culture, but this is what y'all, yo, for y'all to really have a long line and a long career, do the right thing.
Facts.
It will feed you, B. Mm-hmm. This culture will feed you. When you hear, it will feed you. It ain't gonna feed that moment. The moment they're gonna get fed is gonna be a moment. Yo, you remember that? Someone Choice was on the... When Power that year, 2015, remember he had that dope interview?
Yeah, like, Eric's that's right.
The whole time. Remember when? Remember when? You don't want that.
Listen.
You want to be the same thing when you got endorsements coming to and people so interested because they know that you real here.
100%.
That's when the calls start coming in because of you and your man shit start selling. And boom, boom, you start getting, yo, what's going on for me? You know why? Because I'm keeping it 100.
Right.
That's why it's happening for me.
We got to wrap up because we know you got to go, but you're going to come back to the show. Let's talk about your album really quick.
ESP is coming. It's Eric Sermon's Perception. People know what ESP is, but I just put it Eric Sermon's Perception as far as how I look through the eyes of what I'm looking through in hip hop. I was able to gather some friends with me, which is Sheik Luch and Joel Ortiz. My next single is called Clutch.
Mm-hmm.
It's coming out in next week, which is featuring me, Method Man, and Red Man. It's a dope hip hop record. Like I said before, Method Man was able to make me go somewhere I didn't want to go at the time, but it came out dope. And that's my next single. It's called Clutch. You know,
what we want to do is, I know when the album comes out, we want to bring you back.
Right.
If you would have us, we could bring us.
Yeah.
You know, we're going to talk about everything.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Also, while you're here, I want to get you to commit to being the you know, remember when Batman was out with the original Batman when they had the phone and you could pick up the phone and you'd be like, yo, you need some help. We're going to talk to you real quick.
Right.
I want you to commit to being one of New and Wise Bat Lines.
I got you.
All right.
No problem.
Now,
and think about it though, too, you're going to get the real from me. Because again, the real, I'm not afraid to speak it because I'm going to come from One thing about me is the fact that I'm not naive to nothing that's new.
Mm-hmm.
So when people ask me, how you current? Because I know every record.
Right.
I'm not one of the people who don't listen to the records. You see, I named every underground artist. Right. I can name every new one, too. Mm-hmm. No matter what, I understand. I listen so I can be on point, so I won't be sounding old school when I'm rhyming or when I'm saying stuff.
Absolutely.
Know what my metaphor is going to be right. They're going to be like, oh, he paying attention because he just mentioned X, Y, and Z.
Right, that's why
I tell all my veterans, don't be naive. Pay attention. If you coming back in this game, pay attention to the new people and then put your own twist on it.
Right.
Before you get out here, I want to make sure that also when you come back, if you would have us to, would you please do a guest set?
Oh, yeah. Oh, DJing?
Yes.
Yeah, I got you.
Woo!
This is where we're coming at too, because now I get to show you where my brain is at on songs. So it's when I drop records like, you know, Smith and Wesson and Fat Booty by
nice.
Most definitely.
One last thing, I want to run down a couple of names that maybe you may be familiar with, maybe you're not, that I want to pass to you to maybe check out. Dave East is from Harlem. Have you heard of him? If not, I want to pass that music to you. Trey Pizzy from the Bronx.
Mm-hmm.
Troy Ave from Brooklyn, of course you've heard of him. But he also has the kid Young Lito with him.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
There's a guy from the Bronx named Omar Garvey. Very young kid, but he's very inspiring too. We got there's Big B's from Brooklyn. There's Big B's.
Yeah, I think I saw him on Instagram.
You got Manolo Rose from Brooklyn. You heard of him?
Famous kind of.
Sort of.
He's on records though.
He's getting his weight up. But there's a lot of them. There's Young Prince.
My thing is this. Let me check this out.
Mm-hmm.
How does it sound? Me, you, and Choice do a record. Because I got my own label at Capitol.
You do.
We put a record out of all them new people who don't have a platform, and we make a whole album of that new school and promote it.
You heard it here first.
Not just me. We all split the whole thing all together and do something for the new people and for New York and make a splash or something like that. Because I got 2,000 records. Besides, don't forget, me and you producing together.
Yes. Oh my God.
I had Fred the Godson at my house one time. Mm. No lie.
Mm.
He says, Eric, I've been to people's cribs, man. I've been with producers that play beats. Not like this though, man.
It's you. Yo, man.
You know, and the thing about it too, I've been gone for so long.
Right.
So when I sit down there and I play them, I want you to get up and walk out of there.
Right.
I want Danon from D12 to be like, okay, you know what? I call you. Rock Wild and them to be like, you know what? Let me ask you. Mm-hmm. I want you to walk up.
Mm-hmm.
Busta Rhymes called me at 2:30 in the morning one night. Yo, Eric, I'm here with Wayne. Send me some records. I sent him 9 records. He says, oh my God, what the fuck is this?
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, whatever. And then I see him like, yo, Eric, I buy like 4. I put Raekwon on 1. I put so-and-so on 1. Because at the end of the day, that boom bap, only a few of us doing that.
Uh-huh.
Right.
So, again, even though I can trap it too,
right,
because I have fun with it, because I can make it in 5 minutes, no disrespect.
Right.
But sampling and producing with drums and so-and-so a little more different than, doing that.
I can't let you go without me asking this. I know, PR, we got to go. Do you have your eye on any producers out here?
Right now, this is going to be my first time saying this, though, too, but I would love to have a new camp. I would love to have my own hit to say, okay, well, here's Puffy with his squad.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And me back then, I used to have me, Ty Fife, Rockwalla. No, Ty Fife.
Shout out to Ty. He's cool.
Again, at one time I had a few, and I don't have that now. But I would love to take a bunch of new people and, have a sound and put them in the wing.
Because
me having a label, it makes it fun. Yo, I'm at Capitol. You can't get no bigger than that.
Right.
Universal. Yeah. Let's have some fun with it.
How would they be able to reach out to you or something like that in order to do that?
We're going to set something up.
Okay.
What's your
Instagram? You got Instagram?
Instagram is Eric_Sermon, and the Twitter is @IamEricSermon.
Oh, man.
No Green Eye Bandits, no nothing like that?
I don't have that. I got it. You know what? It's crazy, though, because I'm going to start doing some merchandise as far as on that level, so-and-so, to get that going on. But again, I think I'm gonna use that. I have a movie coming too, which is called 88 Fresh with Brett Ratner, who shot Rush Hour 1, Rush Hour 2, Rush Hour 3. Ooh. It's one of the dopest documentaries you're gonna wanna watch as far as people give documentary stories when you see, like, you know, rhyme and reason or you saw the show, but mm-hmm. nah, nothing like this though. This is crazy dope.
We would be remiss if we didn't talk about your rug line.
Oh yeah, this is Def Rugs too, defrugs.com. Look at that though. You know, you saw Floyd Mayweather come out of the plane.
I see Fab.
Yo, you saw Fab. Fab was watching TV. He bugged me out. I didn't know he was gonna do that.
You did one for Clue, you did one for Power.
Yeah, this is gonna be something new that we're gonna be working on that too. But right now you got me excited about them new rappers and doing the CD.
I appreciate that.
Man, Eric Sermon.
Can we please?
This is classic.
He's gonna be back.
We vote.
Let's give a big salute to him, man. Thank you so much
for
stopping by, man.
Appreciate your time, brother. For real.
It was great to talk with that.